So on to Nancy Sheppard. This was the first person that we found that kind of mentions the mill in her testimonies. She survived enslavement, and then honestly, according to her freedmen record, she fought hard for an allotment on which her family could potentially build generational wealth, have safety and security. And we've got a link to the originals below. She was Dawes enrollment number 511. She was 48 when she entered into the freedman role in 1901. We estimate that means she was born in about 1853. Here's one of the gross things. When you're looking for a person who might be related to your family because of enslavement, you have to look for your own last names. So our biggest last name that is very distinctive is Hildebrand, because it's a Swiss-German name. Not a lot of Cherokees with that name. Generally, if someone's Cherokee and their last name is Hildebrand, they are related to us. It's very easy. It's a very simple check on, is this person probably our relative? So Nancy Sheppard, her father, his last name was Hildebrand. His name was Jesse. He was dead by 1901, but he was noted as being from the Illinois district. Her mother was Hannah Hildebrand, also dead in 1901. They were all held in slavery by Mike Hildebrand, and their citizenship is listed as colored. We'll talk about who exactly Mike was later. Nancy's husband was named Morris Sheppard. That's why her last name is Sheppard in her records. He's listed in her card as a non-citizen, but in her testimony, she comments that he is a citizen, but his rights is disputed. He has his own section in the WPA narratives, which we posted below. He gave his testimony when he was 85, reflecting on events that happened when he was a teenager, but he mentions that Nancy was born in Tennessee and then raised at the mill. Her children.
Can I list the children?
Yeah, please list the children.
These are the children in 1901?
Yep.
Okay, Nancy's children were Fanny Sheppard, who was a daughter of age 18. Emma Sheppard was age 16. Annie Sheppard was also a girl named, and she was 14. Thomas Sheppard, her son, was age 12. And Claude Sheppard, her son, was age 10. And then she also had a daughter named Willie M. Sheppard, who was born in 1902. Willie's father was Anderson Penn, who was a United States citizen by adoption. Fanny and Willie were not married, and the form required some crossing out and amendments to note this. Nancy Sheppard was also acted as a midwife for her own daughter and the birth of her granddaughter, and gave her mark on the child's birth affidavit. Lise, do you want to talk about the allotment?
Yeah, so she claimed her allotment of land in the early 1900s, and we're very lucky because her Dawes enrollment packet includes that information, which isn't always the case. She also got allotments for her children and her grandbaby. This is significant since the whole Dawes Commission was, the purpose of it was allotment as a goal, not a side product. So if you have a Dawes Commission application that was approved, that person probably has an allotment. We include a link below about the commission itself and the controversy it created for Cherokees. I think for Americans, it wasn't seen as controversial at all. It was great. It was an important step towards Oklahoma statehood. Those allotments, as unpalatable as they were at the time to many Cherokees, might have formed a basis for this family's security and generational wealth. Generally, when I see an allotment included in a freedman application, I'm happy for them because good. According to a report from ancestry.com, Willie lived to a ripe old age and remained in Oklahoma her whole life. As an aside, when I searched the Oklahoma Historical Society website to find these records, I found another Nancy Sheppard. I got copies of both records just to be safe because I wasn't sure which one I was looking for, and I needed to actually see the record to distinguish the women. And I wanted to contrast the Nancy Sheppard who's associated with our family with this other Nancy Sheppard. She's in roll number 3516. It gives us a glimpse of the chaos and confusion of the post-war period in Indian territory. Her file is the thickest of the four I have addressed, I have accessed. and includes a record of her testimony, a memorandum of application with the word doubtful scribbled across it, two notices to appear before the commission, about 10 pages of further depositions for her and her daughters and her neighbors, a letter of protest from the Cherokee Nation, a stack of letters to and from the commission and the Department of Interior in the case. So I think what's important about this is this sort of reveals or underlines that the Dawes Commission was a federal commission and the Cherokee Nation was participating in the enrollment listing, but largely as a litigant. So we would send, the nation would send lawyers to essentially stack further inquiry on people that they viewed as not, as having a doubtful case. Nancy was 54 in 1901, and her enrollment was finally issued by the commission in 1904. Her file is a fascinating display of early 20th century bureaucracy. It gives a sense of her resolve and interconnectedness. It shows real strength, given that she was born into a system designed to keep her uneducated, exhausted, and alone. Nearly four decades after emancipation, she endured intense scrutiny from federal agents about the details of her early life in order to be counted as a freedman. The second set of testimonies includes attorneys, both her own and one for the Cherokee Nation. One of the witnesses, interestingly, is Emma Hildebrand, who was described as Cherokee by blood. It's interesting because she's probably one of our relatives, although I couldn't find an Emma on any of our readily available records. And I want to talk a little bit about why, or do you want to explain why we think this Mike is Michael Hildebrand and who he is?
Sure. So Michael Hildebrand immigrated to Indian Territory in about 1859, and we have a link to the census records of his moving, basically. He died in January of 1863 at North Fork in the Creek Nation, which is now Eufaula, Oklahoma, at about aged 82. His first wife, Nancy Nanny Martin Hildebrand, was the daughter of Colonel Joseph Martin and Elizabeth Ward, and the granddaughter of Nancy Ward. Before the removal, he lived at, I'm not sure, is it Ocoee?
Ocoee.
Ocoee, now Polk County, Tennessee, where he had a ferry, two mills, and a large farm. His house was where the federal road crossed the river. Nanny died in 1837. Michael then remarried a woman named Lucy Absher, a white woman, in 1839. And it's unclear whether she immigrated to Indian Territory when he did. Michael didn't immigrate to Indian Territory with Peter and Stephen. It appears he immigrated on his own about 20 years later, bringing Nancy and possibly the rest of her family with him. Nancy would have been just a young child at the time. We don't know his motivations to move from Tennessee when he was already in his late 60s, but the timing matches with Morris's testimony that Nancy was born in Tennessee and then raised at the mill, even if the full first names don't match. Hildebrand was an uncommon name in Indian Territory in this era, and there aren't other Michael Hildebrands in the family tree that fit the correct age and time frame to be the Mike mentioned on Nancy's enrollment card. So to kind of tie it all together, Michael was Polly's father-in-law and Julia Ann's grandfather, which makes him our fifth great-grandfather. That makes Nancy Sheppard one of the people whose life was involuntarily linked with our family's history. We can't pay her back or make it right, but we want to say her name, acknowledge her, and do what we can to help her descendants feel sincerely welcome among their fellow Cherokee citizens. People remembered remain a little alive, so here we are today intentionally remembering Nancy.
Yeah, that's a good one. So
we will do some sort of graphic.
We'll do some kind of graphic or something.
So it's not just me saying a list of names.
No, and we've got, the nice thing about this part is we do have lots of material we can turn into graphics. And so speaking of graphics, we will figure out how to make this look cooler for the video. I did end up building a family tree graphic using Find a Grave .com as a starting point. Basically, while I have reasons why I question a lot of those, they're readily available and free. And basically what I did was I would build kind of out a family tree, and we're dealing almost entirely with direct descent. So if someone had lots of siblings, I'm sorry, siblings, I didn't generally include you because it just got too crowded as a graphic, as an image. But basically for each of these, for a lot of these, if I didn't personally know, it's interesting because for me, so our grandfather is LC Neel. That's kind of our entry into this tree, right? LC Neel's our entry. Then we have his mom, Willora, Cleora, Josephine B. Neel. And her photograph, her graduation photo, we think, was in his house. So we have LC, who we personally knew and was alive until a couple of years ago, was alive when we started this project. We have his mom, who we have kind of family stories about, who our mother knew and who we would occasionally get her, you know, LC to talk about. So we have a little information that I personally feel that I count as kind of family oral history, where I feel pretty solid on it. And then we have Julia Ann, who's her mother. And Julia Ann, we're going to dig in this segment, we're going to talk about Julia Ann and what we know about her for sure. And the nice thing about Julia Ann is, because she was our relative ancestor who was enrolled, we have a lot more information about her whole life than is normal for someone who was born in 1852 to their descendants who live now in 2023. And I recognize the privilege of that. So the irony is, the Dawes Rolls and the Dawes process were part of kind of a deep element of surveillance that Cherokees really endured during the turn of the century, last century. But it's yielded all this great information for the descendants. So yay, I guess. But Julia Ann was Polly's daughter. And so that's kind of our bridge to a little more about Polly and her context, is that we have an awful lot relatively of information about Julia. And the irony again being that a lot of the information we even have about Polly is because of, you know, her untimely death. So not great, but also it means that we know more about at least the people who were living at the same time as her because of what happened. So I do use findagrave.com as a start, but again, I try to back up most of the connections that it gives me with primary documents when I have them, or even family oral history when I have that. And sometimes I do. And I acknowledge that some of that isn't, you know, the irony is everything's oral history until someone writes it down. And then suddenly it develops this veneer of respectability. So, you know, it's a little bit of, you know, half dozen of one, six of the other. The other important thing is a lot of the websites that are easy to get a hold of are, you know, contradictory. They're also written by people with agendas. They're almost always written by individual people who just, you know, logged on and got there first. Sometimes you can even see kind of miniature flame wars happening between individuals who have different understandings of the same information. They also never include references, almost never. But visualizing the tree helped us ask researchable questions about our family. How did they come to own and operate this very important piece of regional infrastructure, such as the mill? Did they personally participate in the violence of enslaving? Spoiler alert, we've already talked about, yes. Also, less seriously, how many women in our direct family line had more than three husbands? It's a surprising number, a surprising to me number. Remember when Papa used to joke about that? And then I would be like, shh.
I don't remember that.
Well, I remember it because I thought it was funny. So just so everyone knows, Papa is our family name for my grandfather, LC Neel, and Nana is our grandmother, Ellen Neel. So Ellen, unfortunately, has very few lines in this play, but we'll talk about her some other time. So an important thing is, as Legal Eagle recently pointed out, attorneys often use others' analysis to flesh out their arguments. But as we, as attorneys recently found out, parroting the work of other people isn't always going to be correct. And some of that genealogy websites are essentially ChatGPT for history. Someone will take a similar name, think it's the same person, and link them with someone else. And that's just not always the case. So as much as you can, especially if you're trying to lay groundwork for your own enrollment in a nation, you want to just be sure that as much as you can, you've got whatever documentation you can have. This brings us back to the Dawes Rolls. They're the most complete and widely used mega census of Cherokee in the era immediately following Polly's death. Bringing the Dawes Rolls into this project does feel very personal. Laura, do you want to talk about why the Dawes Rolls is kind of a sensitive topic?
Well, I maybe someone out there knows this, but I remember back in the 90s, I heard this amazing poem, and I feel really bad because I can't remember who wrote it. And I got like 8 books by the woman who I thought wrote it, and I couldn't find it. So it's either she didn't write it or someone else did, or it just wasn't in the particular books that I got from the library. But basically, it was her approaching a record keeper about the Dawes Rolls. And so in modern times, most people's contact with Dawes Rolls are, if they know they have a family connection to someone on the rolls, they can use that to define themselves as legally part of a Native American nation. So according to the poem, and I'm not going to say it nearly as well as she did in the poem, but according to the poem, she walks up to the table, looks at this apparently white guy who's in charge of filing this or getting the file or doing something. And he says to her, "What kind of Indian do you think you are?" In a very condescending way. And in the poem, she like unleashes this like wrath of fury that's just amazing and cool. And I still remember it, even though I don't remember her name or what the name of the poem was or anything else. But in that way, every tool is also a weapon, and every aspect of why a tool was forged is also part of its history. So I do remember Audre Lorde said, you cannot use the master's tools to dismantle the master's house. And some would argue that by participating in using these records as a system of self-governance, that it's perpetuating some of that, so you think you're an Indian feeling. But the problem is, at some point, there has to be a legal ability to define who is part of the group. And so, unfortunately for us, the best tool at our disposal is that tool. The impact and controversy caused by the Dawes Commission on the Cherokee Nation is actually very difficult to overstate. Even at the time, lots of people refused to be enrolled because they felt it was demeaning in some way, or that it was dehumanizing to be counted like cattle, to be written down on a piece of paper and then to be told this is what you are. But you know, unfortunately, it's the main way that we have to connect to that history in a time when birth and death records weren't great, and even if they were, you know, you're still going off of just what people say. That's not always enough for legal things. So when you apply for citizenship among nations that were on the Dawes Rolls, you the easiest way is to connect yourself ancestrally to someone who's on the rolls. The allotment struggle was a part of this issue too. People refused to be a part of it because they thought, if we don't tell them who everyone is, they can't then break up the land and divide it out into families. That's so far in the past that, you know, hopefully a lot of that distress has kind of dissipated. It's now very significant when a Cherokee person finds their ancestor's Dawes record, and you need to know how to find their card number in order to be properly enrolled as a member of the Cherokee Nation. For this reason, interacting with the freedmen rolls to find the people are family enslaved feels transgressive, because it's definitely not how they would have wanted them used. But there's also, there is an element of discomfort for Lisa and I, because again, it means we can't overlook the fact that these people behaved in this way that we find so reprehensible. We will have a link to, you know, some more information about the struggle over allotment. And there's a really good summary of the Dawes Commission's work actually done by the Cherokee Almanac. That's a YouTube video. So we'll have a link to that as well.
Yep.
Lisa, I think you had something really specific about
that. There is a funny thing, but also I think while you were talking, I remembered, I think I know what quote you're thinking of, and I think it's from Faces in the Moon by Betty Louise Bell.
Oh, yay. Okay.
I'll send you the link, and it's...
It has been driving me nuts that I can't remember. But
so
I swear I saw her performing it.
So Betty Louise Bell is in fact still alive. So yeah, so you might have seen Betty Louise Bell talk about her book or perform some poetry based on it. And what's really fascinating, this was one of my favorite books in college, as an aside. I got to take a bunch of Native women's literature classes from Jace Weaver when I was in college. And this is actually her, Betty Louise Bell, novel. It's autobiographical. It's called Faces in the Moon. It was published in 1994. And she's mixed blood Cherokee, is how she talks about herself. And I have the book in the next room. I remember at the time this book being really meaningful for me. It's a great book that explores a lot of the identity issues that we kind of have been, you know, glancing at. And you're probably also thinking Joy Harjo has a number.
Joy is the one. I literally check out every book from the library.
Joy Harjo has a lot of great poems that are also kind of about this, but I think the phrase you're thinking of was actually from the novel Faces of the Moon. So I can look for that in there because I know exactly where my copy of it is. It's in the first bookcase in my library on the upper left hand side, because Bell. Moving on to how memory works. But Joy Harjo also has some good poems where she talks about things that are related to the Dawes Rolls. So hilariously, growing up in Oklahoma, a lot of people say Dawes Rolls, like D-O-S-S, which is what I thought it was for a long time. I didn't actually see it written down until I was in high school, and I finally connected the Dawes Rolls with the General Allotment Act of 1887. I think it was our AP history teacher who told us about it, actually. And I just hadn't, to me, it was, oh, your Dawes Rolls are what you use to authenticate your, you know, when you go to get enrolled as a Cherokee citizen. I thought of them as this, I actually had assumed that Cherokee Nation had taken the rolls ourselves. Like, I hadn't grasped the broader kind of manifest destiny elements of it, which is sort of interesting how it shed that meaning for me anyway. And interestingly, as I dug into this a little bit more just for this video, for our preparation for this, it turns out that, so Dawes, I was like, well, who was Dawes? Like, that's a last name. Henry Lawrence Dawes was a congressperson or senator, was a representative from Massachusetts. And he actually went to the same college I did. And he's buried in Pittsfield, Massachusetts. I'm gonna try to visit his grave next spring when I need to drive up to Vermont from Maryland, because Pittsfield is actually right in the middle of that drive. So I'm gonna go try to visit his grave. But what's interesting is also, again, a lot of people saw at the time the Dawes Rolls and the Dawes Commission as, you know, part of the struggle to control, you know, the struggle to resist control from America by Cherokees. And one of the ironies of that is that, of course, now a lot of us draw a lot of pride from, you know, knowing, you know, being able to prove our Dawes ancestor. But then also from American standpoint, Dawes as a person is viewed as being very friendly and advocating for Indians and for Native people. And in fact, if you read any like article summarizing his life, it talks about how, what a champion he was for the Native Americans. And I think that's just so interesting because, like, from the other side of that, a lot of people at the time saw their Dawes, the Dawes Commission, as, you know, kind of, you know, the boot of the Americans on the Cherokee's neck. And when you read, actually, especially for some of the freedmen records, when you read the Cherokee lawyers' arguments about specific people, you can tell it doesn't feel like it's a collegial relationship between the Dawes Commission and the Cherokee Nation attorneys. It's not, you know, warm, you know, these guys aren't going later afterwards to go have a coffee together. Like, they're not friends.